Sometimes it feels amazing, like flying, when you get completely absorbed into your imagination. But then other times it feels like you're chained to your desk, with each mouse movement and each click taking you further away from that dreamlike state of creativity. And I guess that's why I'm doing this, because I want to break free from all the clicking and typing and make the process feel more like playing an instrument than taming a computer.
For me, it's about emotion. When I'm writing a song, it's all about how it makes me feel, and in the end, that's all that really matters. It's this place somewhere in between being totally focused in the present and reliving memories and emotions from the past. And when you get to that place, everything around you just melts away, and it's just music and emotion flowing through you. There's a big difference between that creative space and the space my mind goes to when I'm focused on using the mouse to move or edit MIDI clips. It just doesn't feel creative or musical to me. So I want to eliminate the mouse from my workflow as much as I can.
Using actual faders and knobs on hardware though, that feels musical to me. So I've decided I'm going to use Chat GPT and try to get it to write the code for a custom MIDI remote script that will transform the Faderport into a device that controls Cubase in a way that I've never controlled it before. Over the next few days, the challenge is to see if I can actually pull this off. Figuring out how to guide AI to write the code properly, even though I don't know how to code myself. While that looked really exciting, it didn't actually work. So as I expected, I think this is going to take a bit of trial and error. It did correctly tell me how to install the MIDI script, so that's a win, kind of. I've already been questioning myself on why I'm even doing this. I'm going to be locked in this room for days, staring at a screen full of code that I don't even understand. I've kind of got it working, but it's doing some really weird things. It's such an iterative process, going back and forth. I'm really relying on AI here to do most of the heavy lifting with this, but the problem is it makes so many mistakes.
Look at this, if I move the third, specifically the third fader, the first fader on the Faderport moves.
At the beginning, I felt like I was going around in circles. Constant iteration over really small things, just trying to get really basic functions set up.
I've been working on this now for literally days. And finally last night, I actually had the first proper breakthrough.
I kind of figured out how to explain things and say things in the right way so that I would get more accurate responses from it. And it started doing some really crazy things. ChatGPT started figuring out ways to use a different method or different functions to kind of hack new functions into the API and into Cubase. I'm starting to think that this actually could be a huge game changer for my workflow. After the past few weeks of working on this thing non-stop, it's finally ready. So the first really cool thing about this is that it works without affecting any of the standard functions of the Faderport. We just need to switch into MIDI mode by pressing down both of these shift buttons. As soon as you're in MIDI mode, everything just works. Easy as that. There's four pages. One of them is for controlling Cubase. The second one is for quick controls, controlling plugins and synthesizers. The other two are just custom pages that anything can be mapped to. So firstly, the quick controls page. Very simple. The first 8 faders are mapped to the focus quick controls, and then the next 8 faders are mapped to the track quick controls. So the way I use the track quick controls, I map them to control the actual synth. And then the focus quick controls are going to be controlling whatever's in focus at the time. The other cool thing is that I've mapped all of these select buttons to open the plugin slots. So there's 16 plugin slots per track, 16 select buttons, so it was a perfect fit. You'll see that when I open the plugins, the actual plugin slot that's open lights up on the Faderport, and I can actually close the plugins just by pressing those buttons and reopen them. Then I can cycle through the active plugin just by hitting the cycle button. Now here's where it gets really interesting. The track button goes to the Cubase control page that I've set up. This is where everything happens. Firstly, the pan knob. I've set the pan knob to actually scroll through the tools at the top, so I can change the tools just using that, and then clicking on the pan knob will change the grid snap. So I normally leave it at adapt to zoom, but depending on how quickly I want my cursor to move, I can change it to bar or beat or whatever I want. Fader 1 and 2 are set to actually control the start and end of any of the events in the project window. So this is really cool. I can literally select anything using the fader port. I can then use the faders to actually adjust the start and end point. So that's on fader 1 and 2. Then fader 3 is set to nudge. So I can actually just completely move the part using the fader with fader 3. And then fader 4, and this one is really awesome. Fader 4 is set up for slip mode. So I can actually move all of the content inside that part without moving the part itself. This is something that I use a lot when I'm experimenting with melodies and rhythm, and maybe I want to move a melody so that it comes a quarter note later or maybe a quarter note earlier. And so this is made really easy just by sliding this fader up and down just to hear what it would sound like when I move the beat to different points. So if I've just maxed the fader out, all I need to do is click on the select button and it will return the fader to the midpoint. Then fader 5 and 6 are set for my fade-ins. So if I select an audio track, I can just use fader 5 and 6 to adjust the fade in and the fade out for that track. Fader 7 controls the waveform height, which is awesome for being able to see more of what's going on if a track is quiet or has some quiet parts. And then fader 8 will adjust the track height of that individual track. Faders 9, 10, and 11 are set up for controlling parts of Cubase. Fader 9 is set up to change the snap type. So normally I leave it at grid relative. Fader 10 changes the grid type, same as pressing in the parameter knob here. Then fader 11 will change the quantize. So I can actually scroll through quantize values just by moving up and down on the fader. Now the next 4 faders, I haven't actually thought of anything to map those to yet. I'll probably play around with this over the next few months and I'm sure I'll come up with something that I want to map to those, but for now, I've pretty much got everything covered. The only other thing that's happening here is on fader 16 where I have the pre-gain map to. That's something that I use a lot, so that's really useful being able to always see where that's set to and always be able to adjust it really quickly on the fly. Now the next part that's a huge thing in this whole setup is this navigation area over here. So this really works alongside all of those faders, especially the first 8 that I mentioned. When I press the channel button in that mode, the knob is set to select events. So scrolling the knob left and right will literally jump to the next and previous event. So that's how I scroll through the parts to actually grab the sections that I want to edit, whether I'm enlarging them, moving them, or slipping the content inside them. Pressing the knob in turns on and off the function that automatically selects whatever event is under the cursor. So I normally leave this turned on so that I can use that specifically for the selection. The previous and next button in this mode just go to the previous and next track. The zoom mode does the same thing as the standard Faderport setup. I think that's pretty important for navigation, so that's specifically just for zoom, vertical and horizontal. The difference with the track zoom that I've set to the fader is that the zoom here will automatically zoom all of the tracks, whereas the one set to the fader is specific to the selected track. The scroll mode is exactly that. It's just a scroll mode for scrolling the cursor. The amount that the cursor scrolls will change depending on the grid type that's selected. And if the grid type is set to use quantize, then I can use the fader to change the quantize value, which will change how sensitive the cursor is. Then the bank mode is for fades. So this is another quick way to do fades. The previous and next button in this mode will set the default fade for the beginning or end point. And the knob is just set to a cursor for selecting events. Now the master and click modes, I've set these up as range selection tools. Using the pan knob, I can switch to the range selection tool. If I go into master mode, I can then scroll the range selection tool through. So when I have the master button selected, I can use the previous and next buttons to jump between the start and end of events and parts. And here's the cool thing. If I change to click and press next, it'll highlight all of that event. Now this is the range selection. Cool thing here is that if I press the knob in, it zooms my window to that selected part. So this is really cool for being able to highlight and see what I'm working on really fast. So then another cool thing here is if I change back to the standard object selection tool and then use the knob, I can actually also nudge the event like that. So it's really cool, really flexible, and an awesome way to just make moving around the project faster. The section and marker modes, these are for locators and markers. If I put it onto the section mode, the knob in both of these mode is set to a scroll. If I click this in, it will create a cycle marker. So I can move my left and right locators just by hitting the previous and next buttons, which makes it really easy to set up my cycle that I want to listen to. Then if I go into the marker mode, what happens then is my previous and next buttons now will jump between markers, and pressing the knob in this mode creates a new marker. So it's just another way to move around the project really fast. So with all of these combined, it literally gives me a way to work on my project without even needing to touch the mouse. There's some things that I'm probably going to need to touch the mouse for, but most of the time I can work in my entire project without even putting my hand over there. And the really cool thing about all of this is that it doesn't just work in the project window, it also works in the piano roll when I'm editing MIDI. So I can also open up a MIDI part and actually edit the MIDI notes using the faders. It's really cool, a really awesome way to actually keep myself in the flow and keep myself using physical hardware. Now, the only other thing to talk about here, above this section, the latch, trim, touch, write, read, they're all mapped to exactly what they say they do. They change automation modes and that's it. The other section below the page selection buttons are set up for track visibility. We've got audio, instruments, bus, VCA, and all. Pressing those will change the visibility of what I can see, which just makes it easier for navigating around the project and through the mixer. Now, this MIDI remote script has been a huge game changer for the way that I actually work on music. It's completely changed my workflow, and it's making me enjoy the whole process even more than I already did. What I'm going to do with this is I'm going to be putting a link in the description. So if you have the Faderport 16, you can download exactly this MIDI script. I've also created a version for the Faderport 8 for anyone that uses that. So you can get either of the MIDI remote scripts for the Faderport 16 or Faderport 8 in the description. And I'm also going to put a link in there for the actual custom GPT that I made that helped me create this script. I will say now though, it's not easy to use. It takes quite a lot of trial and error, but it does get there eventually if you're prepared to do a lot of troubleshooting with it. It was able to create this whole script for me, and I've never done any JavaScript coding before. So if you're patient, and you're willing to take the time to experiment with it, I'm going to leave the link to that in the description. It's trained on the Cubase MIDI Remote API. It's not specific to the Faderport. You can use it for any controller. You're just going to need to tell it a bit about the controller, and you're probably going to have to manually find out the MIDI messages that are being sent by the controller.